Hello, and thank you for joining us today. I have Chris for a conversation about when is the right time to use RPA to extend applications and do integrations, and when might we opt for the more traditional methods of something like an API integration. Before I jump into the questions that I have for you, Chris, for anybody that you aren't a familiar face to, can you please give a quick introduction?
Yes, Emma, thanks for having me on. And I'm very excited to talk about RPA with you. Chris Krause, Principal Consultant and Vice President of our consulting group here at Navient Inc. I've had the pleasure for 16 years of designing and implementing enterprise solutions that leverage APIs and robotics. So very excited to talk about these topics today.
Thank you, Chris. And for fun fact, for anybody that didn't catch it when this series was first starting, Chris was my very first guest on the Digital Transformation Talks. So this one has a special place in my heart that we get to team back up again when we're looking a little fancier with like newer transitions and stuff. So thank you again, Chris, for joining me and for starting what you probably didn't know was going to be a multi-year series. So to get back on track with what we were talking about, I always like to start the conversations with a little bit of level setting to help anybody who's joining us that maybe isn't as familiar with these terms that we use within our industry. So can you start by just talking through a definition of what robotic process automation or RPA is from your point of view?
Absolutely, Emma. So RPA, or as the name implies, robotic process automation, it's been around actually for quite a long time. And usually people first think of robots, they'll think of Rosie from the Jetsons, which I know Emma is your favorite, or R2-D2 from Star Wars, or Lucky Number 5 from the movie Short Circuit. All great robots all around to perform functions that can ultimately save the planet. But in this case, it is not about a physical robot, but rather a virtual robot. And these virtual robots or robotic processes that are created are programmed to perform specific tasks and functions, like, say, retrieving a file from an external website or updating a database from an antiquated legacy system. So they perform these tasks based on a configuration that can be triggered via any automated workflow process. It could be on a specific timer, like check every 5 minutes, or it could be triggered by a user interaction that says, "Hey, Mr. Robot, please help me out and go check to see if this credit report is available." And these digital workforce workers are amazing because they can work 24/7, 365 days, and they also work very accurately. So there's never any type of mistypes as they grab the data and share it between various systems. You can kind of think of it as your newest employee, and you're going to train that new employee to perform some functions. And those functions are to help you and to assist with the processing of various applications. While you are busy working on the more things that you need to have experience with or specific knowledge to perform in order to get that customer experience at the highest level. So you get those exceeding their customer expectations. You get to work with the customers directly rather than performing routine tasks that now your digital workforce is performing. In fact, we have one bank that leveraged 85 of these digital workforces to perform 15 different processes throughout the day on nearly 2 million or so requests annually. So they were performing a lot of different functions repeatedly. And that equated out to be roughly 200 full-time staff to perform those functions if they had to have somebody sitting there performing them. And the robots were able to save roughly 40% of the cost in order to implement that. So it is a very cost-effective way to expand your solutions and bring digital transformation to your organization using robots.
Great. Thank you for that. And now I want to flip it and have you do the same kind of explanation of what API is. Because I think, especially in the business world, we may hear integrations or we may hear API, but what does that really mean? And can you help kind of break that down for us as well?
Absolutely. In layman's terms, API, I mean, a lot of times people get scared. Like you said, they hear it all the time that it is something that everyone just seems to know, but don't really know. And what API stands for is Application Programming Interface. And what it does is it provides a way for two systems to talk to each other given a set of rules. So it's a predefined set of rules that allow two systems to talk to each other. And it is something that is in your everyday life today, whether you know it or not. So every time you open up Facebook, check the weather on your phone, perhaps even booking a flight through Expedia. So Expedia checks to see Delta, do I have an open seat on that particular flight? Or even paying for something via PayPal. Those are all examples where you're using an API to perform those functions. You can imagine if you're sitting down at a really nice sit-down restaurant, waiter comes up to your table, and the waiter takes your order, walks your order back to the kitchen. The kitchen makes the food for you, and then that waiter brings your food back out to your table. In that example, the waiter is an API. It provides the interface between you and the kitchen staff, and it sends the request in and returns back the response of food. APIs are the most direct, secure way to perform any type of integration.
I like that example a lot. It gives a really good visual of an API. And I also like that, you know, we're talking about delivering food and how delicious that can be. So now that we've kind of done that nice introduction to what both of these terms are and how they might fit into an organization, can you help us understand when you would recommend that a customer looks to an API integration, or when bringing in RPA might be the right fit to get their different systems to talk to one another?
Absolutely. And it shouldn't be any surprise to anybody that I love, you know, food reference in trying to explain a concept that's like API. So when we're looking and talking with clients on how can we do integrations and make them successful, because integration points come up all the time when you're deploying an enterprise solution, we always look first at leveraging the API as our primary integration point because it's so secure and it's fast, it's purpose-built. It really is the preferred method for doing an integration if one's available. But there are often times when you can't leverage an API to perform a specific function, and that's where a robot can really help in bridging that gap where you need to extend functionality to a legacy system, like an old green screen sitting in a closet somewhere for those AS400 users, or perhaps to websites that you just don't have control over and aren't extending an API to you, like getting a credit report or going out to other government websites, or even banks or vendor portals. That's where a robot can come in and perform those functions to keep all of your processes moving forward. So first, I recommend the API integration, whether that's REST or SOAP. You want to use that API. Then I follow that up. If that's unavailable, let's try a robot to solve our integration need.
Wonderful. Thank you, Chris, for joining me again for another chat. For anybody that isn't following Chris, make your way over to LinkedIn. Follow him there. And also keep in mind that when you work with Navient, there's a solid chance you might end up with Chris and I as the dream team helping you solve your process problems. So thank you again, Chris, for joining me. And thank you, everybody, for joining us for the conversation. And have a wonderful day.
If you're looking for expert tips on how to get started with your transformation or looking to hone in on your approach, make sure that you subscribe to our channel to catch our weekly digital transformation talk series, where we interview experts from around the world on how to make it happen.